morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good to see everybody here on this Palm Sunday. Got a handful of announcements before we begin with things, and we'll have a number of folks to pray about in our prayers in a few minutes. Prayer slips are in the pews. If you have a prayer that you'd like us to announce, please fill them out, and the ushers will pick them up during the first hymn. This week, we're invited to the noon Holy Week services, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Friday. The churches are listed on the back of your bulletin as to who's hosting which service. On Thursday, we'll come together with First Presbyterian here at our church at 7 o'clock for our Monday, Thursday service, and we will celebrate Holy Communion as we remember Jesus' Last Supper with the disciples. Next Sunday morning for our Easter services, Sunday morning service, the 7 a.m. sunrise service, will be held at the Presbyterian Garden across the street, and Sarah will be preaching at that service. And at 11 o'clock, we'll have our traditional Easter service here in the sanctuary, followed by an Easter egg hunt for the children. And speaking of Easter egg hunts, today after our service, we're invited to the Presbyterian Church for a hot dog fundraiser, and then for the young children and toddlers, there's also going to be an Easter egg hunt. So it'd be something good if you're able. Lunch is easy today. We just cross the street and go have some fellowship. One other thing before we turn it over to Becky for the gospel this morning. When we do the first hymn, you'll notice that the young acolytes are going to be coming up with their palms. So if you're able and you're willing, as they come with the palm procession, if you'll follow behind them with your palms, you'll follow behind and we'll set the palms down at the base of the cross. So with that, Becky, I'll turn it over to you.
And when Jesus had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When he drew near to Bethphage and Bethany, at the mount that is called Olivet, he sent two of the disciples, saying, "Go into the village opposite, where on entering you will find a colt tied, on which no one has ever yet sat. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' you shall say this, 'The Lord has need of it.' So those who were sent went away and found it as he had told them. And as they were untying the colt, its owners said to them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' And they said, 'The Lord has need of it.' And they brought it to Jesus, and throwing their garments on the colt, they set Jesus upon it. And as he rode along, they spread their garments on the road. As Jesus was now drawing near at the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest.' And some of the Pharisees in the multitude said to him, 'Teacher, rebuke your disciples.' Jesus answered, 'I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would cry out.'"
Lift up your heads, O ye mighty gates, and be ye lifted up, ye everlasting doors.
please stay standing as we prepare to read together Psalm 31 on pages 764 and 765 in your hymnal. Please notice that we will sing the first response and we will begin reading at verse 9, which is on the second page. Be gracious. Oh, sorry. Be gracious to me, O Lord, for I am in distress. My eye is wasted from grief, my soul and body also.
For my life is filled with sorrow, and my years with sighing. My strength fails because of my misery, and my bones waste away.
I am the scorn of all my adversaries, a horror to my neighbors, an object of dread to my acquaintances. Those who see me in the street flee from me.
For I have passed out of mind like one who is dead. I have become like a broken vessel.
For I hear the whispering of many, terror all around, as they scheme together against me, as they plot to take my life.
But I trust in you, O Lord. I say, you are
my times are in your hand. Deliver me from the hand of my enemies and persecutors.
Let your face shine on your servant. Save me through your steadfast love.
Seated. The Old Covenant reading today is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 50, verses 4 through 9. If you wish to follow along in your pew Bible, this is found on page 631. The Lord God has given me the tongue of those who are taught, that I may know how to sustain with a word him that is weary. Morning by morning he wakens. He wakens my ear to hear as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I turned not backward. I gave my back to the smiters and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I hid not my face from shame and spitting. For the Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been confounded. Therefore, I have set my face like a flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand together. Who is my adversary? Let him come near to me. Behold, the Lord God helps me. Who will declare me guilty? Today's epistle reading is from the letter to the Philippians, chapter 2, verses 5 through 11. Again, in your pew Bible, this is on page 1023. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped. Excuse me. But he emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
now going to have our time for children. Barbara's going to lead us in that. So if the children would come up to the front, Barbara has a special message for you.
Good morning. I'm glad to have all of you all here today. It was so good to have you come and take part in our Palm Sunday parade. Did you realize that you were in a parade this morning? It wasn't quite like the parades that we're used to having now, was it? When we have parades now, we usually have floats and bands and vehicles and people marching, people walking. Have any of you all ever been to a parade before? Have you ever ridden in a parade before or walked in a parade before? It was fun, wasn't it? Exciting. We get excited when we see a parade. It's usually a special celebration for an occasion like Christmas or homecoming. Or maybe we have a parade for somebody that's been elected and we're celebrating an election, or for a sports team that maybe won the Super Bowl or the World Series, and we get really excited and we get happy and we cheer and we wave to the people that are in the parade. Sometimes we have something like this, like pom-poms. I'm gonna hold on to that. Someone a pom-pom? Pass one back. Have one? Whoops, you have one? Would you like one? You like one? And we would cheer and we would wave at them with the pom-pom and make sure that they noticed us, and people in the parades might have pom-poms and they would wave them. And we'd have important people that were being in the parade. Sometimes, even for important people, they roll out a red carpet for them to have them to walk on, and they sprinkle some of this all over it. Do you know what that is? Confetti. They'll sprinkle confetti. We won't do that up here today. But it would be for a special occasion and to honor somebody that's special and to recognize somebody that's special. Well, in Bible times, their parades were different, and they did have them for important people. And the first Palm Sunday parade was honoring Jesus. He was walking into the city of Jerusalem, and he and his disciples and a lot of other people were traveling into Jerusalem for the Passover. The people out in the countryside were coming in, and they knew Jesus. They recognized him. They may have heard him teach or preach or watched him work some of his miracles, like feeding the 5,000 or healing people, helping lame people to walk or blind people to see, and they thought he was very important. Now, back then, if it had been a king or a general over a big army that was coming into a city, they might have traveled on the back of a big fine horse or ridden in a chariot or even be carried by other people. But Jesus chose to come in on a donkey because he wanted everybody to know that he was not a conquering ruler. He was a servant and a teacher and a leader. He went into Jerusalem, and the people were excited to see him. They reached up into the palm trees, and they broke down palm branches, and they waved them, which is what they would do for a royal person. They also didn't want him getting covered with dust from the dirt roads, so the people took off their coats or their cloaks and they spread them on the ground for Jesus' donkey to walk on so he wouldn't be covered into dust as he went into the city of Jerusalem. And this was the way that he was coming in and began the first days of Holy Week. Now I want to see if you were listening really well when we did this story. So I'm going to say some sentences and tell the story over again. Now if the things that I say are right, I want you to go, yes. Can you do that? Yes. But if I say the wrong words and I tell the story wrong, I want you to go, that's not right. Can you do that? That's not right. Well, let's try with a test. Birds have feathers.
That's not
right. Wait a minute. Listen carefully. Birds have feathers. Yes. Okay. The grass outside is purple. Not right. I can't hear you. All right. Let's go through the story again. Jesus was heading to the city of Charlotte.
That's not right.
Jesus was heading to Jerusalem. Very good. He rode into the city on a bicycle.
That's not right.
No, he rode in on a donkey. The people were so excited that they reached up into the trees and they picked off bananas and waved them at Jesus.
That's not right.
That's not right. They waved palm branches. Very good. All right. They didn't want the dust from the streets to fly up and get Jesus dirty all over, and so they paid him a great honor. All the people took off their shoes and socks and put them down for the donkey to walk on. That's not right. They took off their cloaks or their coats and they put them down. And then they said Hosanna to Jesus as he went into the city. So I think you all did a really good job remembering the story of the first Pom-Pom Sunday. Pom-Pom Sunday? Not right. It was Palm Sunday, Palm Sunday. So I'm going to let you take your pom-poms back with you now. At the end of the service, you can come up and get a palm branch to take home with you. But before we go back to our seats, can we bow our heads and have a little prayer?
Yeah.
Thank you. Dear Lord, thank you for Jesus, who came to be our leader and our teacher and our friend. Amen. Thank you. You may go back to your seats now. You can go back to your mama.
Barbara really has a gift for speaking with children. I think pretty awesome. They were listening. You could tell because they knew what was right and what wasn't. As we go into our prayer today, we'll have our call to prayer and then we'll have a time of silence. And in the time of silence, I'd like you to think about the names that I'm going to call out that was asked to talk about today. And then also think about the metaphor of the wild colt that Jesus rode into Jerusalem. Untamed animal was made tame by the Holy Spirit and by Christ, our Lord and Savior. And that's metaphoric of our lives, because before the Holy Spirit came into our lives, we were like that wild colt. We were unruly and lost. And so as we go into this, let us reflect on all the great things that the Holy Spirit has done in our lives to make us better Christians, or in the sense of the metaphor of a colt, tamed us and taught us how to be a well-trained Christian. Chuck Kizer has moved to Monroe, if you get a chance to go and visit with him. And Daisy is at Forsyth in Winston-Salem. And if you haven't been out to see Ed McBride at Meadowview, please go out to see him. And also Fred has been with him some. Ed has his mind back from the fall, but that means he's not happy because he's not seeing his brothers and sisters here in the church. And so if you get a chance, 5 minutes means the world to him and all of our folks that are in nursing homes. So let us go to prayer with a moment of silence. Lord, we come before you humbled as your people. We come to give thanks for that sacrificial lamb that you gave to save us from our sins, our Lord and Savior, your Son, Jesus Christ. Today we celebrate Palm Sunday as we continue in remembrance of that journey he took to ultimately be sacrificed upon the cross, and to overcome death with the resurrection and fulfillment of the prophecy of the scriptures, and to show us the promise of forgiveness of our sins, and that welcome words to call us home into your kingdom. Please, as we go out into this world over the next week, as with always when we leave our sanctuary here, please fill us with the Holy Spirit, that we may be like an overflowing wellspring that gladly gives that spiritual water of the Holy Spirit to everyone that we meet. Help us to be better Christians, and in doing so, help us to do everything we can to make this world a better place than how we found it. May we be mustard plants in our families, that our children and our grandchildren may be good, God-fearing Christians, so that your word may continue for generations to come. And as we come to the end of Lent and enter into Easter, please fill us with the joy and with the love that Christ showed to us up there on that cross and every day since. In Jesus' name we pray, and we'll pray together as he taught us the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. If the ushers would come forward, we'll have our morning offering. Teach us that while some of us may be able to give a lot, some of us may not be able to give much, but still that gift of willingly giving in your honor is what you want us to understand. So as we give back, Lord, may we give as generously as we can. Amen. Thank you. Our gospel this morning is from Luke, the 22nd chapter, verses 14 through 30. Oh, I'm sorry. I got ahead of myself. Before the choir came up this morning, we said a little short prayer and asked the Lord to give them angelic voices, and I think our prayers were answered this morning. That was beautiful. Before I read the gospel, I'll mention something for the children in here, because sometimes we talk about stuff in the church, and I know when I was your age, I didn't always know what the point of it was, right? I didn't understand the history behind the story. So Jesus going to the Passover supper. The Passover is a celebration with the Jewish nation because it remembers, you've all seen probably the Prince of Egypt, the story of Moses and leading the Jews out of enslavement with the Pharaoh and the king of Egypt. And so right before the Pharaoh ultimately lets Moses take his people and let them go, they sacrificed the lambs and put blood on their doors so that when the plague came through, it would skip over the Jewish nation, but it would inflict the plague on everyone else that wasn't part of the Jewish nation. So the Passover is a remembrance of the Spirit of God passing over the Jewish nation and protecting them during that time of tribulation for Egypt. And as the Jews were to be set free to ultimately come the kingdom of Israel. So the gospel this morning is from Luke chapter 22, verses 14 through 30, and it's about the Last Supper, which is Jesus celebrating the Passover with the disciples. And when the hour came, he sat at table and the apostles with him, and he said to them, I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I shall not eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I tell you that from now on, I shall not drink from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And likewise, the cup after supper, saying, this cup which is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. But behold, the hand of him who betrays me is with me on the table. For the Son of Man goes as it has been determined, but woe to that man by whom he is betrayed. Began to question one another which of them it was that would do this. A dispute also arose among them, which of them was to be regarded as the greatest. And he said to them, the kings of the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and those in authority over them are called benefactors. But not so with you. Rather, let the greatest among you become as the youngest, and the leader is one who serves. For which is greater, one who sits at table or one who serves? Is it not the one who sits at table? But I am among you as one who serves. You are those who have continued with me in my trials, and I assign to you, as my Father assigned to me, a kingdom, that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom, and sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel.
Luke chapter 22, verses 31 through 53. Simon, Behold, Satan demanded to have you, that he might sift you like wheat. But I have prayed for you, that your faith may not fail. And when you have turned again, strengthen your brethren. And he said to him, Lord, I am ready to go with you to prison and to death. He said, I tell you, Peter, the cock will not crow this day until you three times deny that you know me. And he said to them, when I sent you out with no purse or bag or sandals, did you lack anything? They said, nothing. He said to them, but now let him who has a purse take it, and likewise a bag, and let him who has no sword sell his mantle and buy one. For I tell you that this scripture must be fulfilled in me. And he was reckoned with transgressors, for what is written about me has its fulfillment. And they said, look, Lord, here are two swords. And he said to them, it is enough. And he came out and went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. And when he came to the place, he said to them, pray that you may not enter into temptation. And he withdrew from them about a stone's throw, and knelt down and prayed, Father, if thou art willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. And when he rose from prayer, he came to the disciples and found them sleeping for sorrow. And he said to them, why do you sleep? Rise and pray that you may not enter into temptation. While he was still speaking, there came a crowd, and the man called Judas, one of the 12, was leading them. He drew near to Jesus to kiss him. But Jesus said to him, Judas, would you betray the Son of Man with a kiss? And when those who were about him saw what would follow, they said, Lord, shall we strike with the sword? And one of them struck the slave of the high priest and cut off his right ear. But Jesus said, no more of this. And he touched his ear and healed him. Then Jesus said to the chief priest and officers of the temple and elders who had come out against him, have you come out as against a robber with swords and clubs? When I was with you day after day in the temple, you did not lay hands on me, but this is your hour and the power of darkness.
Luke 22, verses 54 through 62. Then they seized him and led him away, bringing him into the high priest's house. Peter followed at a distance. And when they had kindled a fire in the midst of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter sat among them. Then a maid, seeing him as he sat in the light and gazing at him, said, this man was also with him. But he denied it, saying, woman, I do not know him. And a little later, someone else saw him and said, you are also one of them. But Peter said, man, I am not. And after about an interval of about an hour, still another insisted, saying, certainly this man was also with them, for he is a Galilean. But Peter said, man, I do not know what you are saying. And immediately while he was still speaking, the cock crowed. And the Lord turned and looked at Peter. And Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said to him, "Before the cock crows today, you will deny me three times." And he went out and wept bitterly.
Luke 22, verse 63 through 23, verse 25. Now the men who were holding Jesus mocked him and beat him. They also blindfolded him and asked him, "Prophecy, who is it that struck you?" And they spoke many other words against him, reviling him. When day came, the assembly of the elders of the people gathered together, both chief priests and scribes, and they led him away to their council, and they said, "If you are the Christ, tell us." But he said to them, "If I tell you, you will not believe. And if I ask you, you will not answer. But from now on, the Son of Man shall be seated at the right hand of the power of God." And they all said, "Are you the Son of God then?" And he said to them, "You say that I am." And they said, "What further testimony do we need? We have heard it ourselves from his own lips." Then the whole company of them arose and brought him before Pilate. And they began to accuse him, saying, "We found this man perverting our nation and forbidding us to give tribute to Caesar, and saying that he himself is Christ, a king." And Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" And he answered him, "You have said so." And Pilate said to the chief priest and the multitudes, "I find no crime in this man." But they were urgent, saying, "He stirs up the people, teaching throughout all Judea, from Galilee even to this place." When Pilate heard this, he asked whether the man was a Galilean. And when he learned that he belonged to Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him over to Herod, who was himself in Jerusalem at that time. When Herod saw Jesus, he was very glad, for he had long desired to see him, because he had heard about him, and he was hoping to see some sign done by him. So he questioned him at some length, but he made no answer. The chief priest and the scribes stood by, vehemently accusing him. And Herod and his soldiers treated him with contempt and mocked him. Then, arraying him in gorgeous apparel, he sent him back to Pilate. And Herod and Pilate became friends with each other that very day, for before this, they had been at enmity with each other. Pilate then called together the chief priests and the rulers and the people and said to them, "You brought me this man as one who was perverting the people, and after examining him before you, behold, I did not find this man guilty of any of your charges against him. Neither did Herod, for he sent him back to us. Behold, nothing deserving death has been done by him. I will therefore chastise him and release him." But they all cried out together, "Away with this man, and release us to Barabbas," a man who had been thrown into prison for an insurrection started in the city and for murder. Pilate addressed them once more, desiring to release Jesus. But they shouted out, "Crucify, crucify him." A third time he said to them, "Why, what evil has he done? I have found in him no crime deserving death. I will therefore chastise him and release him." But they were urgent, demanding with loud cries that he should be crucified, and their voices prevailed. So Pilate gave sentence that their demand should be granted. He released the man who had been thrown into prison for insurrection and murder, whom they asked for, but Jesus he delivered up to their will.
Oh.
23rd chapter of Luke, verses 26 through 43. And as they led him away, they seized one Simon of Cyrene, who was coming in from the country, and laid on him the cross to carry it behind Jesus. And they followed him a great multitude of the people and of women who bewailed and lamented him. But Jesus, turning to them, said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For behold, the days are coming when they will say, 'Blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never gave suck.' And then they will begin to say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if they do this when the wood is green, what will happen when it is dry? Two others also, who were criminals, were led away to be put to death with him. And when they came to the place which is called the Skull, there they crucified him, and the criminals, one on the right and one on the left. And Jesus said, 'Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do.' And they cast lots to divide his garments. And the people stood by, watching. But the rulers scoffed at him, saying, 'He saved others. Let him save himself, if he is the Christ of God, his chosen one.' And the soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him vinegar, and saying, 'If you are the King of the Jews, save yourselves.' There was also an inscription over him, 'This is the King of the Jews.' One of the criminals who were hanged railed at him, saying, 'Are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us.' But the other rebuked him, saying, 'Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we are receiving the due reward of our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong.' And he said, 'Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.' And Jesus said to him, 'Truly I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise.'"
Luke 23, verses 44 through 49. It was now about the sixth hour, and there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour, while the sun's light failed, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, crying with a loud voice, said, "Father, into thy hands I commit my spirit." And having said this, he breathed his last. Now when the centurion saw what had taken place, he praised God and said, "Certainly, this man was innocent." And all the multitudes who assembled to see the sight, when they saw what had taken place, returned home, beating their breast. And all his acquaintances and the women who had followed him from Galilee stood at a distance and saw these things.
Thank you.
Continuing the 23rd chapter of Luke, verses 50 through 56. Now there was a man named Joseph from the Jewish town of Arimathea. He was a member of the council, a good and righteous man, who had not consented to their purpose and deed, and he was looking for the kingdom of God. This man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then he took it down and wrapped it in a linen shroud and laid him in a rock-hewn tomb where no one had ever yet been laid. It was the day of preparation, and the Sabbath was beginning. The women who had come with him from Galilee followed and saw the tomb and how his body was laid. Then they returned and prepared spices and ornaments. On the Sabbath, they rested according to the commandment.